Good evening. I am Sherelle Williams, Marketing and Program Outreach Associate at the Center for Black Literature at Medgar Evers College. On behalf of the center, welcome to this evening's John Oliver Killens Reading Series program. For tonight's special program, COVID-19 Writers Project, we are delighted to be partnering with BK Readers and Scribd, two Brooklyn-based news sources to share how people in Brooklyn have responded to COVID-19 pandemic. The program this evening is an example of the importance that the center sees in collaborating to present engaging and informative public programs like the one we are hosting tonight. We all benefit when we work together. It is now my pleasure to introduce Clarence Reynolds, Director of the Center. Enjoy tonight's program.
Thank you, Sherelle. And welcome everyone again, as Sherelle said, to this evening's John Oliver Killens Reading Series program. I'm Clarence Reynolds, and we're delighted to have you join us for this special program. It was during this time last year that many of us began to realize the devastating effects that COVID-19 would have on the world and on our communities. After a year in which we have gone through shutdowns, closings, curfews, economic losses, and more than 540,000 deaths, we're still in the midst of a pandemic. In late March of last year, Zawadi Morris set out to gather first-person narratives from as many subjects as possible across Brooklyn for the COVID-19 Writers Project. She wanted to examine the virus's impact from each subject's perspective. Zawadi is the founder and publisher of BK Reader, the first Black-owned and woman-owned digitally daily news site in New York State. In 2000, she formed the Original Media Group, LLC, a bilingual media relations agency. In 2013, Ms. Morris launched the Brooklyn Reader, a hyperlocal digital daily news platform covering Central and East Brooklyn. She was named a 2015 Mover and Shaker in Business by NV Magazine and was part of Goldman Sachs' 10,000 Small Business Accelerator Program. She was also featured in Crain's Business New York. In 2020, Ms. Morris launched Scribe, a nonprofit collaborative news service and digital platform focused on hyperlocal investigative news in underserved communities. She's a member of the local independent online news publisher called Lion, and we're very delighted that she serves on the advisory board of the Center for Black Literature. For this evening's program, we're delighted and proud to be presenting this program along with Scribe, BK Reader, and Amazon Literary Partnership for helping us to put this program together. Please let me introduce to you Ms. Zawadi Morris.
Hello, good evening, everyone. Nice to be here, and thank you for joining me for this evening's presentation. I'm really excited to be able to share my work and project with this particular audience. I've done several presentations like this, but this audience is particularly important to me because it's an audience that's interested in writing, and it's an audience of people of color who are also interested in Black writers. So this is very close to my heart, and thank you for inviting me to the Center of Black Literature. So Clarence, should I just get started in talking about it?
Yes.
Okay. So I guess I'll start by talking about the COVID-19 Writers Project and what it is and the inspiration for it. It's basically a documentary survey of the coronavirus pandemic that happened in 2020 and the impact that this pandemic had on the residents of Brooklyn here. We did this through a series of first-person interviews that we conducted over a period of 6 months, beginning in March when the pandemic first hit, and continue through September after we had come out of the first wave of the pandemic and right before we started experiencing the second wave. But the project was inspired by the WPA program, which, if you're not familiar, is President Franklin Delano Roosevelt's Works Progress Administration program. That was initiated following World War II, and it was put in place to stimulate a creative economy in the United States by basically putting to work artists, including a very large writing core of writers, some of which you may know, like the likes of Zora Neale Hurston, Ralph Ellison, and Claude McKay, and several others, who through the Federal Writers Project were given the task of going into the most remote corners of our country to uncover folk stories and to document the narratives of those lesser known citizens. Also during this time, there were many former slaves that were nearing the ends of their life. They were in their 90s, some approaching 100. And so a team of writers began collecting first person narratives of these slave stories, their experiences. It was very important as they have added historical accuracy to what we truly know to about slavery today. An accuracy that we would not have existed if we had not caught these stories during that time. So as it would have it, these slave narratives that we collected through the FWP program are now archived in the US Library of Congress, and they have ended up being some of the most important and most valued historical American archives to date. So similarly, the C19WP or the COVID-19 Writers Project, like the FWP, aims to serve as an archive of first-person narratives during this an historic time in our history, which was the coronavirus pandemic. So what's central to this was my goal was to basically not only capture this archive, something that we can look back on, but take a snapshot and a survey of who we really are as Americans. What are our value systems? What do we cherish? What don't we cherish? And part of this was guided by a book I read in high school called The Art of War, and by Sun Tzu. And in this book, one of the central themes was this idea that when we're in times of crisis, or when you're in times of conflict, or when you're in times of war, what tools do you use to fight? And this is very important because it identifies your character. Do you choose to use your fists to fight? Do you choose to use a knife? You know, you may choose a gun, or you may choose your words. All these things set the tone or kind of like guide how a person is and their character is in times of conflict, when things are the hardest. And so here we are in the midst of one of the worst crises that I think many of us have ever experienced in our lifetime. I think looking at how we reacted in our response similarly tells us who we are, who our characters, where do we come to help others? Where do we fail to help others? Where are our strengths and what are our weaknesses? And so this I decided to do through a 6-month survey. We broke that survey down into 5 periods across those 6 months, which were crisis, what looked at when the virus first hit, what were we doing? How did we feel about it? Did we believe it? Then it moved into response, which surveys what is our response, which was very, very important because many people felt that the virus wasn't real. Many questioned whether or not it was man-made. Others became very, very fearful. So everyone had a different reaction. And what was the government's reaction? What were our politicians' reactions? What was our local, state, and federal government's reactions, and how did they differ? The next phase was devastation. So devastation took place around late April, early May, and that was during the time where we were in the eye of the storm, where we were experiencing the height of loss. The next phase was awakening. And awakening was an interesting period. It was one that we were not anticipating or expecting, but it happened following the George Floyd protests. And it, to me, signified an important turning point for us because I think many at that point were very weary. Many were just exhausted, tired, frustrated with being in quarantine and hearing the news of George Floyd and feeling the impact of the racial injustice that was happening in the country. I think all of that together became like a perfect storm, and it just kind of caused the country in general to erupt. And after that, the last phase is recovery, it's the fifth phase. And that's how we came out of the pandemic, what our reaction was, how we viewed it, looking in hindsight, how did it change us? And what I found was interesting, even though we laid it out in this way, it follows almost the same stages of loss when we lose someone, you know, starting with crisis, response, devastation, awakening, recovery. It's almost like a circle. So the project in total ended up being 10 videos between 20 to 30 minutes long. It included 5 essays and 5 photo essays. I was really, really excited that we were able to get a mix of experts on a variety of subject matters, race, education, socioeconomics, health. We were able to get on board Dr. Aletha Maybank, who is the American Medical Association Chief Health Equity Officer. We had also Larry Daniel Favors, who is the Group Vice President for the Center for Law and Social Justice. We also had Sheena Wright, who was fantastic. She's the President of the United Way. We even were able to get Dr. Jonathan Metzl, who's the Professor of Sociology and the author of a New York Times bestselling book right now that is out called Dying of Whiteness. So we looked at the intersection of race, education, health, all of those things, and how they played out inside the virus. And then we also had a fantastic lineup of authors and writers that contributed essays, including Sapphire, who is the author of Push. We had the esteemed pleasure of being able to include also Rob Fields, who at the time was the director of Weeksville Heritage Center, and he's also our moderator this evening. And we also were able to get a 17-year-old. It was really important that I had a nice cross-section of ages represented. So this is what we came up with. And I think that if you have an opportunity to check out the full, sit down and just check out the full program and the full project, that I think it will have a huge impact on you. We looked at many, many residents from all demographics, all backgrounds and all ages. And I don't know if, you know, it changed my life. And I'm hoping that if you have a chance to look at it, it will change the way you see yourself inside crisis and your reactions as well. So I'm open to any questions now, if anyone has questions. All right, so I believe what we're gonna do is we're going to look at some snippets from the 5 timelines that I listed out to you: crisis, response, devastation, awakening, and recovery. So you can get a little taste of what it is that we collected. So we're gonna start with crisis. And in crisis, just to review, crisis is looking at the period where we first heard about the virus and our reaction to it.
In early January 2020, the World Health Organization published its first disease outbreak news on the novel coronavirus, also known as COVID-19, a new strain of a highly contagious flu virus first reported in Wuhan, China. On January 20th, the United States reported its first case of the virus in Washington, D.C., and by March 5th, the first case had reached Brooklyn, New York, joining 18 other U.S. states had also reported cases. At the time, the President of the United States, Donald Trump, downplayed the severity of the deadly virus, comparing it to the common flu. Even New York City Mayor Bill de Blasio insisted the risk for contracting COVID-19 was low. He called for vigilance, not alarm. Finally, on March 13th, President Trump declared the COVID-19 pandemic a national emergency in the U.S., the first time such a declaration has been issued over an infectious disease outbreak since 2009.
So we realized, you know, COVID-19 was a crisis really around the month of January and towards kind of mid to late January. And in mid-January, once we started to hear that there were cases that were happening outside of China, the U.S. Airports, the CDC actually began to recommend screening for coronavirus at three of our airports. And then as the month of January went along, it was really by the end of it, as the worldwide death toll started to increase, the number of cases increases, the World Health Organization declared it's a public health emergency, and really just the sixth time in its 72 years. And then a few days after that, at the very end of January and the 31st, the United States federal government declared itself an end COVID crisis here as a public health emergency. This is when global air travel, you know, became restricted, quarantines began to be put in place, and it was really the first time that a quarantine order was issued by the federal government. So we knew, you know, that something was happening, and it was starting to pick up, you know, more and more on the media. It was really until, I would say, late February that the CDC announced that we are now not only in crisis and it's a public health emergency, but we're actually moving towards a pandemic status. We saw illness as it related to death, and then we saw sustained person-to-person spread. We still hadn't seen full, like, worldwide spread yet at the time, but it was starting to build. And then around mid-March, the World Health Organization finally declared that it was a pandemic. There was deep concerns about the spread and concerns about even levels of inaction across the world. And then a few days after that, in mid-March again, the U.S. government declares another emergency.
During the initial stages of the outbreak, I was in another country. So I remember where I was when I heard the first reported case of the coronavirus originating from Wuhan. And I was watching news coverage about it every day, pretty much, because that's what was on the news. So I was in Vietnam. I was actually, you know, somewhat on vacation. I wasn't working there. I was there for about a month. And on my way to Vietnam, my layover city was Wuhan. So I arrived in Vietnam mid-January. And a couple of days later, two or three days later, you know, I'm watching the news and the reports are the first reported case of the coronavirus from Wuhan. I was like, from Wuhan?
So response is the second phase. We had two videos that we produced about 25 minutes apiece for crisis response. Two videos as well. This is the response, the second video. I have an excerpt here. Again, this is where we survey our reaction, which was very critical because our initial reaction to this virus was led by our leadership, which was in discord at the time. We had our state government responding in a different way than our federal government, which responded in a different way than our local municipal and city government. And so there was a lot of confusion, and this is represented, you can see this clearly in this section of our videos. So we can look at this little excerpt.
It came a week after school closed. I was clear at the beginning on the setup, the system, Google Classroom. She's in middle school, so she's got, what, six teachers? But five or six different subjects, different teachers to manage. And so I sort of made the assumption that the teachers would be in great contact with the students. And I pulled out, frankly. I saw what was going on. I saw that she had her passwords, her setup, her laptop, gave her a notebook to make sure she's sort of keeping track of her to-dos. And I pulled away. I think what really frustrated me toward the end of the school year was learning that Maya had been sort of not working at her highest capacity, is how the teachers described it to me, as Maya's a top student who wasn't doing top work, but don't worry about it because we're in a global pandemic. I didn't get any word of that at any point throughout the semester. And the explanation behind that was we were dealing with, you know, children who weren't top students before the pandemic who were struggling even more.
Because this was something that was thrust upon families and educators, you know, overnight, there was no time for adequate training, looking at the data to identify which forms of most remote learning are most effective, to find out which children are matched best with which types of remote learning. So there was literally no evidence that one had to operate on to institute across school systems, across the country, this remote learning.
I don't like school to begin with. The only reason why I really even caught up with my credits and started attending school is because I transferred to an alternative school. And in that school, it was a smaller school and there was a lot of social interaction. I developed relationships there, so it was easier for me to stay in that environment. But in my old school, it was like 4,000 kids and the teachers weren't really my type of people and the students either, so I couldn't really focus. So remote learning in itself just was very difficult because I struggled with doing schoolwork from the comfort of my own home because it was hard. It was really difficult because, like, I feel like part of what makes learning, like, interesting to me is social interaction and, you know, actually conversing and debating and, like, understanding certain things, but through conversation and, like, interaction. Like, I can't really do it. Like, if you give me something that I'm not interested in and you tell me to do it, I might try and focus on it, but I have a very short attention span to things that I don't have much interest in.
I'm very concerned because, you know, 13-year-old boys don't do social distancing. You know, I'm sure when he gets around his friends, they're going to fall into their regular cadence of how they engage. And so just being very clear about that, like, there's just no way we can keep children, you know, 6 feet apart all day in school with masks on. And just trying to assess the risk of infection, and not only for him, but what he could bring home or to other kind of older or health challenged family members. So that's a big concern. There's also concern that he's losing so much of learning, you know, opportunities and learning time, and also just the socialization and, you know, depression that could set in. You know, he's big into sports. I mean, he loves sports. So to not be able to do that also has a toll and an impact.
For me, the challenge.
It came a week.
Okay, so that was a response. And I focused on, there were several things that were taking place in response in our reaction. But I focused on the distance learning for just that portion because that had such a huge impact, not only on our adult population, but those who had children. So it was a huge portion of our population that was impacted by our response and our readiness to be able to deal with that sort of crisis. The next section is devastation. This is when we were in, again, the eye of the storm, where we experienced loss, not only loss of job, we saw loss of lives and livelihoods. We saw a loss of being able to socialize. There was just loss across the board. And so we take a look at what that meant on a very granular level. And just this is just a quick snippet.
It was just shaking because his name is Daniel Turner. He is Coney Island's, like, he's one of the Coney Island people who starts basketball tournaments. just do stuff for the community. So when he passed away, his death shocked a lot of people in my building, 2940. He was like a great role model to all the young Black men in the community. And my sister was on the phone with her best friend, and it was just in tears together. Like, I view them as family because we grew up together, all our families. And it was just so shocking. She said her father was fine 1 minute. When he went to the hospital, he was like, he was talking, he was fine. He just had the coronavirus. But then the next day they found out he passed away. And I heard some people saying that it's what the nurses and it's what the hospitals are giving to them that's killing them. Like, I don't remember what the name was called, but I heard many nurses and doctors come forward saying that this stuff is killing the patients instead of helping them. So with this coronavirus and stuff, people are getting scared. And when people are scared of the unknown, that's when people lash out. That's when people start to fight back. And that's why people, I feel like some people start not to care because one, they don't know what's going on. Two, they're too scared to address what's going on. And three, like, it's just, it's no talks about it. So they don't know what to do. And that's scary for kids with health problems. That's scary for old people. Like I said, my sister's best friend, father and grandmother passed away just like 2 weeks after each other or the same week. That shook the whole family. So even though it was a pandemic, my mother was going to their house because, like I said, they family to us, and checking up on things. She couldn't, like, she was having like a panic attack. Her mother and her favorite brother passed away. So it's hitting people really hard. And I feel like Trump and everybody in his camp should really double down on stuff like this and talk about it instead of just blaming China, because that's exactly what he's doing.
I'm so sorry. It's very upsetting. My mom is the matriarch of my family, and we all love her so much. And before the pandemic, we were able to visit her. You know, I gave her massages, I sang to her. She has Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and she fell and broke her hip, so she can't walk right now. And I'm sorry, can't walk right now. And so she's in a wheelchair, and she really looked forward to seeing us. And when they shut everything down, I was not able to see my mom. I called every day. I tried to bring her food because she does not like the food in the nursing home. She's at Susan B. Anthony Nursing Home, Susan B. McKinney Nursing Home. And so what's been going on is I've called, I tried to get in to see her. They said, no, cannot see anyone. Then I found out to another friend that many people died in that nursing home where my mom is. And of course I went berserk and I kept calling. I'm like, why can't I see my mom? Why can't I speak to her? And there was really no proper reason why we couldn't see her even by FaceTime. So what I did was I ended up calling Mr. Eric Adams, our borough president. Luckily I had his number.
It was just
manage COVID-19 properly.
If you think about the healthcare industry in New York City and how many Black women and Black men are a part of the home health aid industry, how many of them are a part of the nursing corps, how many of them make up the social workers, how many of them make up those positions that are at their heart really responsible for whatever we now are calling the remnants of society continuing to function. They are the ones who literally were at risk and could not avoid those risks in the ways that those of us who were able to work from home were able to do so. And that is largely panned out based on racial lines.
I actually tested positive for COVID-19 at the beginning of April, and trying to get my doctor to get me. And I was mildly symptomatic, just trying. And I have good insurance and I have good healthcare and top of the line, everything. I mean, trying to get a test for me was, and I'm in public health, you know, I had to work hard to convince my doctor to give me a test. But I knew that I had been exposed and I knew what some of the risk factors were. But you know, if you don't have those means that even, you know, for people who don't have insurance, don't have top of the line, you know, healthcare, who don't have the, who aren't empowered enough to be able to even try to convince their doctor or have the means to convince their doctor to test them. Because many physicians were not testing people. Now testing's a bit more widely available, but you know, unless you had you met a certain symptom profile, you couldn't get tested. So there's, you know, these barriers are deeply seated and rooted. They go back in our country. They go back all the way to, you know, slavery and antebellum.
You saw police
and it's COVID-19.
Okay, so that was devastation. That was a little bit of devastation. That one was, that section was particularly heady for me. It's very heavy, but it was an important one to document. So we spent a little bit more time in pulling some survey from that. The next section is awakening. Again, this was the period. It was kind of like a turning point for many people in the United States when they just were fed up and ready to see change and ready to see action. They were ready to move from inaction to action, and they channeled that all into this desire for racial and social justice. And this section we call Awakening.
I think that young people are able to rise up during this pandemic, kind of influenced by the pandemic, because you know, in a situation where we as young people are definitely more adept and used to internet and, you know, using online platforms, it's easier for us to organize and speak and voice out our opinions. So that is one thing that we like have an advantage as compared to other age groups. So it's much more easier for us to use social media and online platforms to organize, which is why you see a lot of, you know, organizations, events, just like being organized and being hosted by young people. Another thing is that I feel like young people tend to be, like I mentioned briefly before, young people tend to not be as motivated by like power or like money or other, you know, external factors. They tend to be more focused on this desire to create positive change. And I feel like that's such a pure, like useful energy. And I feel like that's not something influenced by the pandemic. It's just something realized during this time where you can connect with people much more easily. And young people are starting to like just come together a lot more and a lot more frequently and just, you know, it just happens.
It really does require us to think differently, particularly because right now, when we think about what makes up our society, we're talking about the fundamental breakdown of our economy, the fundamental breakdown of our healthcare system, the fundamental breakdown of our education system. And when those things have been broken down, now is a phenomenal time to be thinking about what should replace the systems that we had, recognizing that what was the normal was not equitable. And if it's not equitable, we cannot return to normal or to business as usual. Now is the time for us to reimagine and to rebuild different systems that are going to center the needs of all of us.
They're scared of us to have knowledge, because once we have knowledge, it turns into stuff like this. It turns into meetings, it turns into protests, it turns into boycotts, it turns into things that actually make a difference, and they're terrified of that. They're terrified, because at the end of the day, when we all come together, it's literally unstoppable.
It's not just white. They're afraid of you. That's what it is. They're afraid of black and brown people. That's right. That's right, and I'm saying it. That's right, and I'm saying it. They're afraid. They're afraid. And that's exactly what it is. And I'm sorry, and I'm saying it. They're afraid. They've always been afraid. And I don't know why. We can all live here. There's plenty of room for everybody. There's room for everybody.
They fear unity. They fear the minority to come to an understanding and start understanding who they are and what power that they have. They fear people rising up and rebelling. Because when we do, it's going to be a problem. And if things don't fix and if things don't change, it's going to keep getting worse from here. We've been at the bottom for too long, for no reason. We've been targeted for too long, for no reason. They got to.
I think that young people are able to rise up during this pandemic.
So that was awakening. Thank you for that. That was awakening. That one was also very emotional. So the interesting thing about this, watching these videos, if you ever have the chance, they take it really does take you through an emotional roller coaster. Not only is it a review of what we all went through, it's looking at everybody's experience just in each phase is it's really riveting. So this last phase, which is, I keep calling it my favorite, this the recovery phase to me is very important. It's when we really kind of take stock of not only the impact, but also some of the positive things that happened as a result of this pandemic, how we were forced to kind of rally together under dire circumstances. There were many people who learned how to redo the things they thought they were doing before was the only way. People learned how to improvise. And there was loss too. There was retrospect and looking at what could have been done better. So this was a very valuable point in our documentation and survey is the recovery.
If the world is different, I mean, imagine if we're not worried having to look at the newspaper every day to see what next horrible thing happened. How's it gonna be to live without constant shocks? I don't know. If that takes a while to, it's like when somebody dies, it takes a long time before you stop expecting to see them out the corner of your eye or in the other room. You know, I'm just gonna go over there and talk. Oh, wait a minute, they're dead. You know, it's like, it takes a long time to really know they're gone. It'll take a long time to really know this is gone.
Good work.
I think society has already changed. We've already learned how to people, elderlies that I know, and I call them elderlies, but the people who are, you know, 60 and above, even 50 and above, 60 and above, who never wanted to deal with computers, never wanted to deal with social media, never wanted to, you know, learn how to deal with money in that way. They've been forced to do it. They've been forced to get on Zoom. They've been forced to learn about Cash App. You know, people are, oh, no, just give me my money. No, so now they've learned how to do these things. And I laugh, I'm like, oh, now you know how to get on Zoom and all the other things and check in on Facebook to see what's happening. So that's a big change. People are learning how to be home, cook more, learn about, I have friends that have learned how to grow their own food. They're very good at it now. They grow their own food in their backyards. People are learning how to connect with their family members and have a good time at home on your block. I've seen people, my neighbors would be across the street and they would set up like little tents and DJs and have little birthday parties in their front yards. And so I think that it's like, in a way it's going back, but it's a change that we are learning how to be more, how to connect with each other in a different kind of way.
I felt that this was needed. I'm not gonna hold you. I felt that this was needed because everybody was on go mode. It was just like, you don't really know, like you didn't really know what was gonna be what. So it was just like, now you have time to relax and now you have time to yourself to plan. And when things do start to open, hopefully they do, because these riots ain't it. But you know, you can have your plan going and you can have what you want to do and how you want to do it and how you're gonna get it executed, because it's only you that's gonna make you progress.
A lot of babies were born. Ha! I love that. I never had babies, but I love the fact that babies were born. It's such a blessing from our Lord. I believe in God so much. God has blessed me with so many things. Look, God blessed me with health. He's so awesome. He's the greatest. You know, so I think God is so awesome. And I think God is working so hard right now. This whole thing, if people don't know, this whole thing is spiritual. You have to know it. That's all I know.
Thank you so much, Zawadi, for sharing those clips with us. And I hope that our audience members will tune into the website Scribe and BK Reader and also the Pulitzer Center to view the entire 10 videos that you have in the entire program. I'm now going to introduce Rob Fields, who's an arts leader and founder of the New Black Imagination Festival, a celebration of Black people and ideas that are pushing contemporary culture forward. Rob is the former president of the Weeksville Heritage Center, the Brooklyn-based Cultural Center and Historical House Museum. And he was also a contributor to the COVID-19 Writers Project. So after the Rob, there you go, man.
Thank you. Thank you, Clarence. And I want to take a minute and just welcome everyone in the audience here tonight for this discussion. I want to shout out the other panelists here, Zawadi, Nigel, Fumilayo. We've got some great conversation coming up here. Before we start, there was just two quick points I would love to make about this because there's some things that I want to make sure don't get lost. One is that the importance of a project like the COVID-19 Writers Project really is that it captures a moment in time or some finite moments in time that are going to give us a chance to look back, process, and understand what last year was about and what we're still going through. And that is so important as we are living and surviving and trying to deal with such seismic change, the opportunity to look back on and process. The second piece that I think is also important, and we're going to get into this as well, particularly with Zawadi and Nigel, is this is an example of the kinds of things you can do when you've got hyper-local journalism. I think that is super important to discuss the ways in which the news ecosystem has made it hard, and the economics of the news business have made it hard for us to really get this sort of insider view of what is happening in our communities and be able to sort of have both the national and international, but really looking at what's going on in our communities. So this project and the work that Zawadi and the team are doing at BK Reader, other organizations like Our Time Press, all of that is about sort of helping you be informed about what's going on in your community. And that's really important. So I just want to say that so we can sort of have that as part of this conversation as well, because it is a factor. So let's just jump into this conversation. You know, I'm going to be here. Obviously, you've met Zawadi, Nigel Roberts, who's also going to be joining us in this conversation, is a New York City-based journalist, award-winning freelance journalist, and he has extensive experience covering politics, and he is a proud veteran of the United States Air Force, and so I want to thank him for his service. The third panelist who's going to be sharing some perspective is Fumilayo Chesney, who is a performing artist. She is a dancer, choreographer, and artistic director of Fuchsia Dance Company, located in New York City. She is someone who believes in the power of movement, not only as expression, but movement as a way, as a path towards health. So I want to welcome her here as well. So the first question I think I want to throw out to use Zawadi is, he's really talking about this from the standpoint of how this project relates to the larger work that you're doing with BK Reader, specifically as it relates to hyperlocal journalism and why it was important to, you know, you said you started this in April. Why was it important to do this project and why to do it this way with as oral histories?
Thank you for that. So the project was conceived after upon two premises. Number one, after I had a conversation with a good friend about the FWP, the Federal Writers Project, we were discussing it and we were discussing the oral slave narratives, and how important that was and how much of history might be changed or retold had we not captured that. And we were just going into quarantine and the newspaper got very, very busy almost overnight. We were responding almost frenetically to whatever emerging news was coming out, as it was a very, very new virus. Everybody was scared. We found ourselves kind of running around, frantically trying to make sure that we were on top of any new information that dropped. And what I felt was happening is that in that process, I was hearing stories from people personally who were calling me, and then also from a few interviews of people experiencing this virus in such disparate and different ways. You know, there were some who lost their jobs entirely, while there were others who maintained their jobs and were working from home. There were those who all of a sudden had a nice little break and were on unemployment. And then there were others who were very much so struggling to figure out how they were going to eat the next week. And I knew that all of this had to do with the way our society socially, the way we have set up our economy and our institutions and how we're impacted through race, how we're impacted through health insurance, all of these things all started coming to the fore. And that in tandem with the conversation I was having about the Federal Writers Project, I said, we need to slow down. I was like, as a news organization, we need to take a moment, take a breath, and we need to capture these stories right now, because we're gonna run through this pandemic and kind of, we have short memories as Americans. So we're gonna run through this pandemic. We'll have our own personal stories, but we're gonna forget about them. And America's good for that too, of having a very short memory. I said, we need to capture how this is impacting everybody in society, particularly in the communities I was covered, which were underserved. And so I said, I want to do something that's similar to the oral slave narratives and begin to at least collect and document what's happening to serve as an archive. So it was those two things. And also my love of storytelling and the importance of storytelling, all those things together to me meant it was time to kind of slow down and pull this together. I also thought about Anne Frank, something that I read in junior high, The Diary of Anne mm-hmm. Frank, and how, had her family, she was 12 years old, had she not kept that diary, we would not have had that really inside, bird's eye view of what was happening to a family, on a very, very granular level, what's happening to this family that was hiding out in the attic in the midst of the Holocaust. So all those things together, I knew it was time. This was the perfect time. I reached out to Brooklyn Community Foundation. They immediately, within like 3 weeks, provided me a grant. I knew that, that was to provide 8 stories. I knew that as soon as I started endeavoring that was not going to be comprehensive enough. So I reached out to Pulitzer. They immediately, in 2 weeks, they were like, we were just talking about the Federal Writers Project. This is relevant. It's important. Mm-hmm. Go for it. They gave me a grant. After Pulitzer came National Geographic, and then American Medical Association followed. And I had a wonderful experience. Everybody I reached out to understood the depth and the relevance of this type of project, and they jumped on board immediately, including yourself. Thank you. everyone saw the importance of capturing this moment. So.
Yeah, that's fantastic. That's fantastic. Can I quickly go to Fumi Lyle? Can you join us here? I would love to ask you a question. You gave that sort of were so brave and to share what you were dealing with your mother. And you were understandably stressed by what was going on, with her, with that situation. I also have a mother who's been in a nursing home as well. So I definitely can relate. But in what ways was your participation in this project, was it helpful as you navigated just the various things you were dealing with with the pandemic, just in terms of your mom and just seeing everything else that was going on throughout your family, the city, with your work? And how did the pandemic, how did this project help you navigate? Oh, Fumi, your audio's not on. Got to unmute. Okay. There you go.
Gotcha. It was wonderful to be able to express and get it off my chest by getting involved with this project. It was great. It was a great release, and able to share my story and also help me to navigate ways of trying to get my mom out of the nursing home and try to be very vigilant, but it didn't work because I was not able to get her out of the nursing home, and she ended up dying because of negligence.
So sorry.
Cuomo, you know, we should have been able to get our family members out if we wanted to. I think that was one really huge mistake that happened. Because of that, many, many people lost family members in nursing homes. So.
Well, thank you for sharing that.
Great. Yes.
And definitely condolences for your loss. That's, you know, this has been a year of, in many ways, unnecessary loss, just on a whole lot of levels, with family, with friends, with jobs. I mean, this is why a project like this sort of gives, I think, people a chance to reflect, have catharsis, and get through this, because we are still dealing with this. And I know that, you know, in your case, you're still dealing with the loss of your family's matriarch. So again, thank you for sharing. Thank you.
Rob, is it okay if I jump in just for
please,
a moment?
Please, this? I was coming to you next.
So when Zawadi and I first started talking about this project, it wasn't, the scope of it was a lot smaller. And I knew that people were dealing with the loss of loved ones, and that was going to become an issue. But one of the things that surprised me, and I guess in hindsight, it should not have surprised me, was that there were so many people who needed to talk. They needed someone to listen to them. People were mm-hmm. dealing with isolation and the loss of income. You know, just so many issues, and they needed to talk. They needed to get these things off their chest. And you're right, it was cathartic, you know. So it was, and in many ways, that kind of helped me also, you know, to know that I was able to help people just to connect with someone else, you know, while they're right. feeling so isolated during the lockdown.
Right. Right. Absolutely. Absolutely. And so, you know, the thing I was going to ask you also was just as you were thinking about, you and Zawadi were thinking about the project and formulating it. It was very much an oral history project in a lot of ways. How do you think your training as a journalist prepared you for that piece of it? You know, the fact that it was really, it was less about sort of the data and more about the experience that people were trying to get to. How did you approach that?
Yeah. So I think one of the things that I did in terms of my approach was to sort of draw on my experience of doing personal profiles.
Mm.
And one of the things that made this, my background is in print. Let me say that. And of course, in print, people get to know the subjects through me, you know, through the words that I choose to use, right? I'm a filter, you know? And so in approaching this, I drew upon the skill of making a personal connection to people, right? I felt like I really needed to make them feel comfortable with me, you know, talking about very personal things, and that I wouldn't be judgmental. And so one of the things that I did And using that approach was before we started videotaping, was to just give folks a call first and just have a conversation, get to know each other off camera, you know, so that they can loosen up and share their experiences.
No, that's awesome. That's awesome. That's awesome. And I guess I'm going to jump back to Zawadi. Can you talk about any of the challenges? And I guess both you and Nigel can kind of talk about the challenges of the project that you faced, and like how you sort of decided what to include and what not to, because there's a lot out there. What were some of the challenges you faced in getting this done? Zawadi, you want to join? Do you want to take that one or start?
Sure. I think for me, thank you for that. I think for me, there were quite a few challenges, but for me, what was one of the hardest challenges was reaching the more the underserved and the that population that we don't often, the unheard population, mm-hmm. That we often don't hear from. And so as a news publisher, that's always been my goal. That was my initial goal in launching in underreported and underserved neighborhoods. And so not initially being able to get them to talk in a pandemic was, you know, upsetting for me. You know, how do you approach someone who's homeless? How do you approach someone who's, you know, struggling in the projects and not sure how they're going to eat the next week? How do you approach someone who's recently incarcerated or, you know, has just, you know, gotten out of prison? That population was really important. I wanted a true cross-section of people and those who are sick. How do you approach them and say, hi, you know, walk up to a homeless person. Do you want to be a part of my, you know, COVID-19 Writers Project and talk to me, when their immediate need has nothing to do with my interview? So, and, you know, as a journalist, we're not supposed to pay people for interviews, but I came to a point where I finally understood that I have to meet people where they're at. And these people right now, their immediate need is food, their immediate need is money. And so then I changed, I decided, you know what, this is different. This is a documentary. I'm gonna at least meet them, you know, where their need is. So I remember one day in particular, I was coming back from the beach with a group of friends. We had just finished talking about this challenge. We were at the end of the project. It was August. And I said, you know what? I had so many people of high repute and so many professionals jump on to this project. And, you know, immediately they got it. I was like, but I did not get that that segment that is often skipped and not heard. And I said, I feel awful concluding this project and didn't achieve that. And we were driving up Atlantic Avenue, and my friend in the backseat, there was a guy that was crossing right in the middle of traffic, like he was about to get hit with a sign that says, recently out of prison, homeless, need money. And my friend in the backseat said, Zawadi, stop the car and ask him right now. I was like, we're in the middle of traffic. He's like, stop the car. I pulled off. Cars were honking at me. I got out the car. I went up to him. I said, excuse me, sir. I'm sorry to you know, just walk up on you like this, but I'm part of a project that's documenting what's happening in the pandemic. And we want to make sure all voices are heard. And I wanted to know if there's any opportunity that you might want to talk to me. And he said, you know what, sis, the fact that you just acknowledged me, and I've been out here all day, no one's stopping, no one has talked to me. He's like, I just feel good that you're just stopping to talk to me. He's like, yes, I'll be a part of your project, sis, whatever you need from me. And that was before I offered compensation. So I said, oh, I was like, that would be fantastic. Do you have a cell phone? He said, yes. I said, I'm gonna call you, here's my card, and there's compensation. And for every referral you have, there's another compensation. And let me tell you, by the time I got back to my desk after the beach, I had about 3 phone calls. It was like the movie Ghost. You see one, they all start coming out the woodwork. It really, like, I was overwhelmed with people calling. I'm a security guard, or I, you know, have HIV and I was homeless. I want to be a part of your project. And then they referred somebody else. Then we suddenly got a flood of people who wanted to be in the project, mostly because they felt, one person in particular told me, you know, I feel invisible. And if you're telling me this is an archive and this is going to make me visible, I want to be a part of it. He's like, you know, and there was another Mary. I don't know if you remember her, a white woman in the end that was, you know, telling it like it is and saying, you know, this is all about God. She was our superstar. She actually is HIV positive. She was one of the people that was referred by that person I ran into on the street. And she was, you know, basically kicked out of her house when she was a teenager and has been off in and out of the streets, you know, became Christian. And, you know, she's just was an amazing, amazing person. So the best stories we gleaned were from those right at the very end, I felt, you know, very, very intelligent because they've lived, they've really lived. And had so much good things to contribute to the project. That was the biggest challenge. We overcame it. It just lets me know that you got to push and you got to meet people where they're at when you're in the midst of these types of documentations.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you for that. That's really helpful to understand. Fumila, I want to come back to you. You know, I think of you and just re-watching your story, you know, as somebody who teaches dance, someone who believes in movement as healing. Can you talk about how you've processed this whole period, given that we've been living through this period where it's a time of survival, and our survival really has been about curtailing movement? You know, we've been limited in how we can move. So how is somebody who's so connected to movement like you, how have you dealt with this and how are you dealing with this?
I actually never stopped moving. That's how I dealt with it. I started doing Zoom classes, even though they were not the same as doing a live class. I did like three classes a week on Zoom, and then I started a class in Fort Greene Park to get people outside. And up to now, we're still doing the Fort Greene Park class on Zoom until it's over 50 degrees, then we're gonna be outside.
I hear that.
So my way of dealing with it was to move.
That's great. I think the other thing that I wanted to, you know, sort of touch on is that we've talked about how this is an act of journalism. It is an act of oral archiving. It is a means of catharsis. But another big piece of this is the study guides and lesson plan. Can you guys talk, you and Nigel Zawadi, talk about, you know, the development of the study guides for this? Because I'm assuming there was a big push to get this into schools to sort of foster some discussion and some educational activities that are around this project.
Yes, thank you. So the Pulitzer Center approached us about, they were very pleased with the project. You know, they contributed $10,000 to the project and were not expecting what they got back from it. It was much bigger for everybody than what was expected. And so they approached me about putting together a curriculum, and which eventually became a lesson plan, which is a scaled down version of a curriculum. But I was really excited about that. It's a curriculum for middle schoolers, and it allows them to study every of the five, the story arc of the pandemic, and then kind of have a talk back. They're the same curriculum developers as those of the 1619 project. Yeah, the New York Times 1619, they were hired by New York Times to pull together the curriculum for the 60s. So I'm so honored that Pulitzer has a curriculum for this project. Now, again, it's more of a lesson plan. So we're fundraising right now on iFundWomen to build it into a full out curriculum for both middle school, seventh, you know, through eighth graders, and 9 through 12, and possibly even college. It's a very layered project. We look at so many aspects of society, and there's a lot to discuss. If you even in one video, we have 10, and so that's what we're working on right now, is fundraising to build out a much larger scale curriculum.
Can all of you talk, because I want to be mindful of the time here, can all of you talk about the ways in which this project has changed you? I know you mentioned that you've been profoundly changed by this project, Zawadi, but I'd love to hear from Milau and Nigel as well as you, just to talk about what What does this do for you? What, how are you different now on the other side of, you know, how are you different from the person who said, hey, I've got this idea. We've got this idea. Fumilao, how are you different from the person who like, okay, I'll do this oral history, this oral archiving. How are you all different now?
Wait,
Don't all talk at the same time.
It's very quick. I don't know so much that I'm different. It kind of reinforced to me what the work that I'm doing, why I did it, and why it's so important. It's so important that all of our voices are heard. It's so important when we're talking about growing together and working together in empathy that we hear everybody's story. And I'm so gratified that I pushed and was able to get everybody's voice. We literally got from 9-year-olds up to 90-year-olds on this project from all walks of life. And we heard how they were each impacted. And each of their stories, you know, even those that you might think had it easy, everybody had a struggle within it. And everybody had something they took away and learned from it. And those being able to connect with people and stay connected in this time of the internet, and this oral history to me, you know, this archive is going to be tremendously valuable. And yeah, that's what I gained from it. It was a reinforcement of the work that I'm doing now.
Great.
I came away from the project feeling hopeful about, you know, the human spirit. You know, I saw people who became very resilient. You know, as things got tough, they got tougher. There was one young lady who, she was a college student. In fact, she was the first person that I interviewed, you know, during the lockdown. And you could feel when I spoke with her and when you watched the video, you could still feel the fear that she felt just going to a supermarket, just trying to feed herself and her family. Yeah, and she was, as I said, she was a college student. She had a lot of trouble, you know, trying to navigate the tools for remote learning. And she felt like because of that, she was going to fail her classes. Mm-hmm. By our third interview, she was cooking her own meals. Before that, she wasn't cooking, but she was learning how to cook her own meals. You know, she was using the food pantry at the school. You know, she built a steel in her spine, you know. Mm-hmm. And it just, I walked away just feeling very hopeful about the human spirit. And just about everyone, when you look at their experiences in the beginning and how fearful they were and the anxiety that they felt justifiably, you know, and you look at who they became at the by our third interview, it's amazing.
That's great.
And, I'm going to say the same. I was kind of nervous, definitely, about certain things, especially, for example, taking the COVID test. I was like one of those people that was very like, I don't want that up my nose. But I got over that hump and I'm able to just go and get the test without freaking out. Mm-hmm. It empowered me in weird ways because I was able to now communicate with my clients in a different way and also communicate with clients in other parts of the world because everything was virtual. So students I haven't seen in many years, I was able to see because we were able to set up a Zoom meeting and they were able to come and connect. So it's, you know, it's ups and downs, definitely a lot more ups because we're learning more skills.
Right.
And so, yeah.
Do you guys think that this kind of documentation, this is for all three of you, will continue just given, again, what we've all learned about technology, the value you all have gotten out of being in a project like this? Can you see sort of this sort of video documentation of work, of your lives continuing, you know, beyond this project?
I'm seeing a little notice that the Q&A portion is starting. Is that what we're in right now? or is there a Q&A from the audience that we're doing?
I think there probably will be some Q&A from the audience, so maybe we should go to that because we are up on 7:48. And I'm sure people have some questions. So Clarence, are you coming back for questions? Yes. Clarence,
yes,
will save the day once again.
Yes, yes. Believe it or not, I think that's a good question you had, Rob. You've been asking some fantastic questions. So I think you can go ahead and ask that question because I really wanted to know myself, like what's going to be moving forward with this sort of.
Yeah, I guess this is the easier way to ask that question is what's next for everyone and will it include this? My assumption is that we've all begun to understand the value of documenting through video what we're doing and how our lives are progressing. Do you all see that continuing in your work beyond this project in any respects?
Yeah, you know, One of the challenges that I faced when this project started was mastering Zoom. using Zoom for documentation.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't alone. So, you know, I came away from this learning a new skill. And I think going forward, you know, in answering the question, I think going forward, Zoom or whatever evolves after Zoom creates a new platform for us to do journalism, mm-hmm. you know, with people anywhere in the world. So I'm very hopeful about what's coming next, and I'm looking forward to being a part of that next wave.
Awesome. Awesome. Bring it back to journalism.
I'm looking forward to the same, to being part of the live and the virtual aspect of what I do, because mm-hmm. there's definitely a lot of opportunities for virtual. And when we start opening up again, then I'll be going live. So it's a wonderful combination.
Awesome. Zawadi?
Well, yeah, I definitely see the value. We're still doing our daily news site, and mm-hmm. I think that this has changed a little bit the way we're reporting. We're looking to, now that we can access people so much easier over Zoom, we're looking to do more video stories, and we're trying to elicit more personal narratives in those stories. We just ran one yesterday, which you should check out on bkreader.com. you know, about dealing with her apartment building, her home and development and gentrification. And I think that we took a lot of notes in that video from what we did from the COVID-19 Writers Project. So it's definitely reflecting the way I work now and the expectations that I have for my journalists now too.
Great.
Okay, one person had sent and wanted to find out, did anyone know of, someone wanted to know more about the number of Blacks affected in Brooklyn. Might you have some numbers, the number of people, like population-wise?
The number of Black people affected by COVID
in Brooklyn, yes.
Sick or death?
They just said affected, so I'm not sure, but if you have, sick or deaths, that might answer that. Hopefully that might answer that question.
I don't know it off the top of my head because it changes every day, but the great thing is we're the only local daily news site that has a daily tracker. Okay. So if you want the answer to that question, you can go to bkreader.com. Right at the top, you'll see a COVID-19 tracker, and it tells you every day how many hospitalizations, how many deaths, and how many sick. And yes.
Mm-hmm. That's for Central Brooklyn?
That's for all of Brooklyn.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's a tracker for, we had it built for, we're working with an agency that built it exclusively for us.
Oh, that's great. I was about to ask you, because you know they just retired the COVID tracking project.
Oh, I didn't know.
Because the guys at the Atlantic were just like, look, the government can do this now. So
yeah.
I was just wondering if that's where you were getting your numbers, because that's the...
This is on a hyper-local level. This is just...
Oh, great.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. So another reason to check out hyper-local sites. and support hyperlocal journalism.
DK Reader, yeah. Donna Hill asks, how do you determine who to interview when you did this project?
Okay, I'm gonna let Nigel take that. We worked together, but it was always this person told us about this person who told us about this person. There were, I'd say about 40% of them we selected in terms of our experts and then people that we knew. And then we asked them to tell us about someone else they knew. I was trying not to get too much in my own inner circle. I was trying to really push outside of that. And then, you know, Nigel, did you want to chime in?
I think you mentioned earlier that we wanted to make sure we had a broad demographic so that we weren't focusing just on, you know, a few groups of people. And that sort of was created a guideline for who we should select. But we really depended on team members, right, to go through their address book, who do you know, and ask those people who they knew. And that's pretty much how we did it. But we wanted to make sure, you know, that we got in some young people in there who, as was mentioned, the death of George Floyd, you know, which was kind of unexpected, and that wasn't in our original planning. It became a very big issue, you know, during our taping. And some of the young people that I interviewed in the very beginning, I tried to get them to talk about COVID, but the conversation always went back to the protest and the Black Lives Matter movement. So that just shows the importance of trying to get a cross section of people, because we may not have been thinking about certain things. And here it was that they were drawing some connections for us between the pandemic and the murder of George Floyd.
Mm-hmm. Donna also wanted to find out, did you use all the interviews that you gathered?
So we used all the subjects that we interviewed, but we gathered over 50 hours of footage. And ultimately that was produced down to 5 hours. So we have so much on the cutting floor, it's crazy. There was a lot that could have been included that was extremely interesting. But so even the 10 videos that you see there, as mm-hmm. long as they may feel, we had so much more. There was so much more.
And can I just jump in here and just say to everyone and encourage everyone, this was one project, but so many of you, most of you out there have smartphones or access to smartphones or computers. I encourage people to record their own stories in terms of how are you processing this moment we're living through? How's your family doing? I encourage you to interview the elders in your family. It's so very important to have that history, because as Zawadi said in the beginning, so much this moment's going to go by and then we're going to be on to something else, or, you know, the constant sort of challenges that we all face. But it's important to document this moment. And if you think about it in terms of, again, a way for you to process how this has happened, also for future generations in your family to see how you went through this, or how did the matriarch of your family do this? I mean, we often overlook the fact that we are walking around, so many of us, with supercomputers in our pockets. And it's so, the recording and interviewing is there. Just, you know, ask people to just how they're processing this. I can say that, you know, where I used to work at Weeksville, they are offering courses intermittently on being your own family historian. So definitely keep an eye out for that, and how to sort of be your family's archivist, or just how to best ways to go about interviewing family members. But please consider doing that, because these stories are so important. Even if no one outside your family hears it, you will have it for future generations. So that's my two cents on that.
Well, the last question I'm going to ask, and this comes from Bridget Davis, and this piggybacks on what you were just talking about documentation, Rob. She asked, are there plans to create a book from the stories collected?
Center for Black Literature.
That's right. No, I hadn't thought about a book. What I was working on, there's two projects I'm fundraising for. One was the curriculum, and the second is an actual documentary, a 90-minute documentary. We have so much footage, like I mentioned before, and I wanted to do something where we could update this footage, include this footage, and then also update. So currently, we have 5 hours total of footage that's part of the project. Wanted to pare that down to the best 90 minutes or the best 60 minutes or so, and some updates and a little bit more, you know, produced experts chiming in. So, but I'm fundraising for that as well. Book, I'll put that in the Center for Black Literature's hands. I can be a consultant.
All about funding and getting things done. Yeah. I want to thank you all. I'd now like to bring on Dr. Brenda Green, the founder and executive director of the Center for Black Literature.
Greetings, everyone. This has been really such an exciting program and very informative and stimulating. And I thank you for documenting our stories. You know, if we don't tell our stories, we will forget. So we have to keep telling our stories and remembering. You know, I love what you said, Rob, about, you know, we have to do this all the time. You know, we have to make sure that we document the stories of the people in our families and our friends, and we keep a record. And I thank you, Zawadi, for your vision. You know, the Federal Writers Project, going back, you know, we're gonna have this forever. And there are just so many ways to expand this. And Nigel, thank you so much. Being an excellent partner, giving it that other perspective and making sure we have the print. And for Maleo, it was just you showed why it's important to tell stories, and the emotions that you conveyed were just really so moving. So again, as I said, if we don't tell our stories, we forget. Rob, you did such a good job asking questions that we didn't even have many questions. So thank you for your moderation of this. And I also would like to thank our team, Clarence Reynolds, who's the director of the Center for Black Literature, Sherelle Williams, our program associates, our communications and marketing team, Akila Worksongs. I want to especially thank all of our attendees for coming and sharing and listening, and hope that this was an informative evening. I see several of my students are here. So thank you for attending. Remember, you're going to be writing about this and sharing your reflections on this. We have a survey we'd like you to complete. It gives us information and shows us how to plan for future programs. And also, I'd like to tell you about some of our other programs at the Center for Black Literature. We have an upcoming program. Our next program is Saturday, March the 27th, which is the National Black Writers Biennial Symposium. We are telling the stories of two writers who have been what we call unsung, Paul Marshall and John A. Williams. We are honoring their lives and telling their stories. We have a wonderful, stellar array of speakers, of scholars and writers. They include Eshwich Dondekad, Ishmael Reed, Lawrence Jackson, Mary Helen Washington. These are some people you may know, but these are the people who are doing the work of making sure these writers' stories are told. There'll be a roundtable discussion of people who knew them talking about their work. There are going to be dramatic readings by Michael Green and Liza Jesse Peterson. And thank you, got it, Liza Jesse Peterson. And we're going to have a special musical tribute with Donna Tulewu Cumberbatch, who actually currently lives in the house that Paul Marshall lived in. We're having a keynote conversation with the scholars Lawrence Jackson, who wrote about the indignant generation, the writers who came of age in World War II, or after World War II, during World War II and after World War II, and Mary Helen Washington, who's currently working on a biography of Paul Marshall. So it'll be really, really a wonderful day, an exciting day. It's free for CUNY faculty and students, very, very nominally donation for everyone else. That I hope that you will join us. And then in April, we have a program with Talib Kweli. He has a new book, Vibrate Higher. That'll be April the 11th. So we invite you to come to, no, it's not April, April the 8th. April the 8th. We invite you to attend that program. Go to our website. You will see all of the information. We are upgrading our website, so we don't have as much as we normally have. And I encourage you to also donate and support us. We're able to do programs like this and to have them free and open to the public and to have a nominal fee. So I encourage you to donate. If you go to the Center for Black Literature, you can hit the donate button. So again, thank you so much for attending this program. Thank you for supporting us. Thank you, Zawadi, and your team for this very important work and for your vision. And we will see you soon.
Thank you.
Okay, bye, everyone.